Well, good evening and welcome. It's great to see those of you here who want to learn more about transit in your area. I have to tell you, I'm from Spokane, so this is really a lesson for me here. I'm Ann Murphy. I'm president of the League of Women Voters of the Washington Education Fund. And the League, along with the Seattle King County League, is so pleased to present this informational forum of the measure that's on your ballot for Sound Transit 3. Ever since the founding of the League almost 100 years ago, a significant part of our mission has been to provide nonpartisan voter education. Integral to that mission is that the League is nonpartisan and does not endorse or oppose any candidate or political party, but rather to provide a venue for you to learn more about issues that are important to all of us, and especially this one on transportation. How long did it take some of you to get here tonight? It took us a while coming over from the other side, since this is the east side, but I'm really from the true east side. So at this time, I want to thank the work of League members Cynthia Stewart and Janet Winans and other Seattle King County volunteers who pulled this forum together. So thank you. The League is also sponsoring other forums around the state for statewide offices, not just these forums for your regional issue here in these three counties. TVW is airing those forums, as well as this, and this one is being taped in full by the City of Bellevue TV and will air in the coming weeks. With that in mind, there is to be no other taping in the auditorium. So thank you all for turning off those electronic devices. And you can find up-to-date information on our website as to when these various forums will be rebroadcast, and that's at lwvwa.org. The League also sponsors an online voters pamphlet with candidate and issue information at vote411.org. And most importantly, in order to vote, I'm sure all of you know, you have to be registered. But if you know folks who need to get registered, you can do that at online by October 10th, but if you're going to mail it in, do it by October 8th because of the holiday on the 10th. And you can register up to October 31 in person at your local elections office. Our Vote 411 site has more information on that. Additionally, the League has information in the hall here at this live forum on how you can be registered and how you can be involved in the League's work. So thank you all for your interest in the election process and this issue in particular, and we hope that you find this forum helpful. At this time, I introduce Amanda Clark, who is the president of the Seattle King County League. Amanda?
Thank you, Anne. I'm delighted to be here, and I'm delighted to see all of you here. I would like to actually thank the three county leagues who are sponsoring a series of these forums where Sound Transit will be on the ballot. That's the Pierce, Snohomish, and of course, King County. And Janet Winans and Cynthia Stewart, as Anne said, who really brought this particular forum together. I would like also to reiterate what Anne said about the League's nonpartisan policy. The League of Women Voters neither supports nor opposes political candidates and neither supports nor opposes political parties. We are, however, a political organization, and we work collaboratively to influence public policy through education and advocacy, basing our positions on in-depth study. Those positions that we have in turn will influence the decisions that we make for endorsements. So we feel that these forums are very important to us, the League, as well as to the public, to learn more about what Sound Transit 3 really is. So I would now like to introduce Simone Alisea from the new KNKX, who is going to be our moderator. Simone is a Seattle native and former KPLU, now KNKX, intern. She returned to the Pacific Northwest from covering breaking news at the Chicago Sun-Times. She earned her Bachelor's of Journalism degree from the Medill School of Journalism at Northwestern University. And during her undergraduate career, she spent time in Cape Town, South Africa, covering metro news for the Cape Times. Now I'll turn it over to Simone, who will explain the ground rules and the procedures for tonight's forum. Simone.
Hello and good evening, everybody. So the first thing I want to do is I want to explain the ground rules for the forum and then the subsequent questions that I'm sure you guys will ask. First things first, please turn off all cell phones. If you haven't done that yet, please do that now. From this point on, no applause or expressions of support or opposition at any time during the forum. We want everyone to hear everyone's ideas. Audience questions will be reserved for the Q&A period, so we're not going to take questions until then. The questions will be submitted in writing and collected by volunteers who will then give them to me. The way you do that is you will see on your chairs you have little index cards and little golf pencils. If at any point you have a question, write it down, raise your hand, someone will come and collect it, and then give it to me, and it will be asked during the Q&A portion. So the questions can be addressed to any speaker. Other speakers can also provide additional information. So if you address one to someone, another person can also help you understand that. We're also going to enforce standard rules of civil behavior, which means you cannot interject comments. We will allow you to take still photos, provided there's no disruption to anyone else in the audience. Photographers cannot move from their seats or otherwise block the audience view. There will be no digital recording of the program except for our lovely TV crew here authorized to produce video here tonight. There will be no signs or banners or other visual distractions from the audience. And if there are violations, I will stop the program, turn off the microphones, and I will ask you to leave. If necessary, I will ask someone to help me make you leave if it gets really bad. But I don't think that'll happen tonight. The League of Women Voters adheres strictly to the requirements of the FCC regarding use of tapes or films made during a League-sponsored forum or debate. Any use of the tapes requires the approval of the League of Women Voters and the authorized television station, with the caveat that it must only be broadcast in its entirety. No campaign will be allowed to use or edit the footage for campaign purposes. So, just so everyone knows. Now, without further ado, I would like to introduce the people who are going to be speaking tonight. I'll introduce all of you, and then our first speaker will come up and make their presentation. The first person you're going to hear from tonight is Karen Kitsis. She's the Senior Planning Manager at Sound Transit, and she's going to give you an overview of ST3 and what the proposal says. Speaking for the pro side, we have King County Councilmember Claudia Balducci, and she's speaking on behalf of Mass Transit Now. On the con side, we have Bellevue City Council member Kevin Wallace, who will be speaking for People for Smarter Transit. So Karen, if you'd like to come up and give it a go.
Thank you for your patience while we were moving around there. Hi, my name is Karen Kitsis, and it is a privilege to be here tonight, and I appreciate y'all coming out, especially on one of our few remaining lovely evenings here in September. I did want to start by saying that I will be providing a technical overview of the plan and the information, and can address questions in that regard once we get to that session. Questions that are more of an opinion nature will be best to those that are on the panel. The Puget Sound is growing. We are looking at adding 800,000 people by 2040. This is a great place to live. It's gorgeous. The economy is thriving. I moved here 4 years ago, so I'm one of those folks that have very much come to appreciate how lovely it is here. And as our forecasting shows us, there will be others that will want to move here over the next 25 years. Right now, we have, or 2 years ago, there were about 2.9 million people that lived in the region. We are forecast to have another 800,000. Just last year, 52,000 people moved here. That's about 1,000 a week. If you think about what that means for congestion on our roads and our ability to move around the region. Population and job growth are great for the economy and make for an exciting place to live, but it also means that we need to look at how people are able to move around. It is taking longer to get around our region. Between 2010 and 2015, congestion on our freeways increased by 95%. More specifically, folks who commute in the Seattle area are now spending 63 hours a year stuck in traffic. One of the foundational elements of the transit service that Sound Transit looks to provide is light rail. And one of the reasons for that you can see on this graphic. It can take one light rail car, one train with four cars to move about 800 people. That's about 10 buses, which is also a service that Sound Transit provides and I'll be speaking to. That is the equivalent of about 500 cars. So when we're thinking about how the region can grow and how we can look to move those people that will move here, we are looking at light rail and bus traveling and HOV as a way that folks can move around regardless of weather or traffic and use less space, if you will, to move those folks around. A little bit more information on the Sound Transit District. We are made up of the urbanized areas of Snohomish County, Pierce County, and King County, and then broken into five sub-areas, East King, where we are tonight, North King and South King, and then the county to the north and to the south, Pierce and Snohomish. It's about 2.9 million people. That's about 40% of the state's population. That was an incredible factoid to me when I first moved here. A lot of people in a fairly small area when you consider the state size. Sound Transit is governed by an 18-member board of elected officials in the state, a Secretary of Transportation. As I mentioned, we operate light rail service, ST Express bus service, as well as commuter rail. We have a light rail service that currently operates from UW down to SeaTac, with another station slated to open later this year, which I will speak to in a moment. Since 2001, all of Sound Transit's light rail projects have been on time and on budget, and here you can see those shown. The initial segment opened in 2009 on schedule and $100 million under budget. U-Link, which opened in March of this year, opened 6 months ahead of schedule and $200 million under budget. Engle Lake, which is slated to open in this month, is on schedule and trending under budget as well. The rest of the projects that we'll speak to, I'll speak to a little bit, in ST2 are also still on schedule and on budget. While we're talking about Sound Transit 3, there is still a lot of Sound Transit 2, the voter-approved 15-year capital project that passed in 2008. With the opening of Capitol Hill and UW, daily light rail stations, daily ridership has increased to 63,000 a day. That is 76% increase overall from last year. We are looking to open additional station south of SeaTac, as I mentioned. Next slide. In addition to that, we will have a continuous system of station build out with Northgate in 2021, Tacoma Link, the light rail system that's within the city of Tacoma, East Link down to Bellevue in 2023, Linwood Link also in 2023, and Kentamoy in the following year. This will enable our system to grow to 54 miles total length. And as the system grows, so does our ridership. In 2015, we had 35 million rides. With ST3, we are estimating at 216 million passengers a year. Now for some more specifics on the ST3 plan. The ST3 plan impacts all three modes, Link, Sounder, and bus services. It will connect on the Link Light Rail system, 116-mile regional system with 11 cities. We will have bus rapid transit north, east, and south of Lake Washington, more Sounder commuter rail service in the south, as well as ST Express bus service that will continue, and improved access. I would point out soundtransit3.org. It's an important website where all of the information, technical information about our plan can be found. We also have folios in the back that summarize that information for you if you'd like to pick those up. With the light rail system at 116 miles, we'll have 62 miles, I'm sorry, we'll have 37 new stations, and we will complete what is known as the light rail spine service north to Everett, south to Tacoma, and then finish the East Link line to downtown Redmond, as well as an additional line between South Kirkland to Issaquah, and additional service in the Seattle area with light rail to Ballard and West Seattle. We'll also extend Tacoma Link, which is within the city of Tacoma, to Tacoma Community College. Altogether, these changes will result in 695,000 additional riders by 2040. This slide shows the time frames for the development of that plan. In 2024, we would have service to downtown Redmond and extend Kent Des Moines to Federal Way. 6 years later, we would have delivery of service, light rail service to Tacoma Dome, and then West Seattle to downtown Seattle. Ballard to downtown Seattle, which would include a new downtown light rail subway or tunnel, would open the following year. Linwood to Everett via Painfield Southwest Everett Industrial Center would open in 2036. The Tacoma Link extension that I mentioned would open 3 years later, followed in 2041 with South Kirkland to Issaquah service. I should also mention that we have within this plan new light rail service at three stations on the existing Link line. That would be at South Graham Street, South Boeing Access Road, and Northeast 130th Street in Seattle. Next slide. One element that I want to highlight that's new within Sound Transit's portfolio of transit service is bus rapid transit. We have two lines, both that are scheduled to be delivered in the 2024 timeframe. The first would bring bus rapid transit between Linwood to Burien and would utilize the express toll lanes between Kirkland and Bellevue, and then that are to be open to Renton. And then additionally to that, we would have bus rapid transit service using bus access transit lanes on 522 around the north end of the lake, connecting to 405, and then also connecting to 145th, to the light rail station that is being built as part of ST2 and Shoreline. We will also have ongoing ST Express bus service. The useful and interesting elements of the bus rapid transit service are that it will be fast, frequent, and reliable. Fast because it will utilize elements of off-board fare collection, meaning you can tap one off the bus, you can utilize several doors to entry. It will also be frequent, up to 10 minutes during the peak hours. By that I mean the hours that most people travel to and from work. And it will be reliable, utilizing the bus, utilizing the express toll lanes that WashDOT is investing in. This slide shows the increased improved travel times compared to bus service now between Linwood to Bellevue, Bellevue to South Renton, and then South Renton to Burien. As you can see, in several of these instances, travel is increased or improved by upwards of 20 minutes. As a summary slide, this shows the major projects that can be found on the east side. The first two are light rail that include the extension of East Link to downtown Redmond, South Kirkland to Issaquah, the 405 light rail service that will be along for on the east side, and then 518 closer to Burien, the 522 service. We also include future studies within ST3, so that is for future expansion of the overall system, as well as is a study looking at connections between Bothell and Bellevue for high capacity transit alternatives. We also include parking and other access improvements, in particular at North Sammamish, as shown on this map. The funding for this plan is proposed with new sales tax, additional MVET, and a property tax of 25 cents per thousand of assessed value. Across our Sound Transit district, this shows a typical amount of being $169 per year or $14 per month. This slide shows, I've talked about the projects and what elements the cost will be going towards. This one shows the overall funding. It is a $54 billion project, a package to be delivered over 25 years. And it is a combination of bonds, existing taxes, fare, and interest earnings, which make up about 21.7. Federal grants contribute about 4.7, and then you have the new taxes that we spoke about. One thing I want to highlight is that Sound Transit as an agency, particularly since 2001, is one that has rigorous oversight and cost controls. As I mentioned, our projects have stayed on budget and on schedule, and a lot of that is in part due to internal controls, but also external. The Federal Transit Administration reviews us quarterly. The State Auditor's Office performs an annual accountability audit. And local jurisdictions, in working with us, demand a rigorous process, whether it's for the planning of our projects or for the permitting to allow them to be constructed. We have ongoing public oversight with a 15-member citizens oversight panel. In addition, Sound Transit 3, with the Sound Transit 3 website, make sure that all of the information that has gone into development of this plan is available to the public. One element that's required for our plan development, and this is unique to transit agencies, at least those that I've worked with and those that I've worked with at Sound Transit, the state requires, and it's a part of our enabling legislation, that an expert review panel reviews the development of our plan and has to sign off that the methodologies that we utilize to come up with our costs and travel times and ridership estimates are sound. That panel has met several times over the course of the last year as we have developed that plan, and we are awaiting a final letter that will say that our methodologies have been found to be adequate or meet the requirements for development of such a plan. Another area that I wanted to mention within our within what makes up how Sound Transit does its business is sub-area equity. Our plan clearly identifies what sub-area or local funding sources are being collected and then how they're being paid for projects that are within that area. It is a part of our financial policies that the board has to make the decision about projects that are within a sub-area. Funds can only be spent on those projects that are benefit to that sub-area. A note about overall benefits of our plan. The biggest off the bat is that this will save time and therefore money. In 2015, the Puget Sound lost $783 million to delay that was caused by congestion. Our plan will create jobs, over 78,000 direct jobs, almost 150,000 indirect jobs. By completion of ST3, 84% of the region residents and employees, 93% of employees will have access to that transit service. So we are creating a network that connects growth centers, urban growth centers within our district and enables folks that live in and amongst those areas to reach places they want to go, whether it's work or travel or play. There's also environmental benefits to our plan. Here summarized with some examples. This will save 793 metric tons of GHG annually, and that is one of the ones I like, 4,200 rail cars of coal savings on an annual basis. This slide is hard to see, but I think it's evidence of a couple of things. The green are ST3 projects, ones that would be part of November's ballot. The blue are projects that we already have voter approval for and are under development. Those are the circles on the left side of the page. What this shows is we have a lot that we're doing, a lot that we hope to do, but combined together, the ST2 and ST3 would enable the region to receive an ongoing delivery of projects on a 2 to 3 year basis throughout the next 25 years. It would set the foundation for future generations to be able to move through this region and have an alternative to congestion rather than sitting on 405, 90, or I-5 that happens to a lot of us now. Thank you for the opportunity to come and talk with you about this. When we get to the Q&A session, I'll be happy to answer technical questions or questions about the program itself. Thank you.
It's good to thank our speakers anyway. I'm gonna just really quickly reintroduce Claudia Balducci, who is going to speak on behalf of the pro side for ST3.
Well, thank you. My name is Claudia Balducci, and I am here on behalf of Mass Transit Now to urge your support for Sound Transit Proposition 1, as it will appear on your ballot, which is the opportunity of our generation to build out our long-awaited, desperately needed regional transit system. I know some of you here, but for those of you who don't know me, I have been a resident of the Lake Hills neighborhood, just right up the road here in Bellevue, for over 20 years. I served for 12 years on the Bellevue City Council, including 2 years as mayor, which I completed just last year. I'm the current King County Council member for this district, which covers most of the inner suburbs of the East Side. And for well over a decade, I have represented this area on transportation issues. I have served on a number of committees. I was a member and past chair of the East Side Transportation Partnership, which is a group of governments that advocate on behalf of the East Side. I'm a member and past chair of the Puget Sound Regional Council's Transportation Policy Board. I have been a member of project advisory committees for large state projects like the 520 Bridge Replacement Project, the 405, and other projects. And I'm a current Sound Transit board member where I've served for several years since 2010. So I have dedicated an enormous amount of my time and of my life to the cause of improving transportation in Bellevue, on the East Side, throughout the region. I've advocated for investments in all modes of travel, in roads and our freeways, for safe bicycle paths, pedestrian and sidewalks and crosswalks, and yes, I have been a proud advocate for transit. So why? This is not something I set out to do for a living. Those of you who follow local government probably know that being a city elected official in most places outside of Seattle is a part-time job, and this was not my job. But you can't be involved in any kind of representative municipal governance without quickly learning that transportation is the number one challenge facing virtually every one of our residents every single day. It is in their faces, in our faces, behind the wheel, on the buses, everywhere we go. It is the number one problem identified in our city surveys at the city of Bellevue and at other jurisdictions. It has been identified as the biggest risk to our continuing economic success as a region. It's one of the top barriers to opportunity and a good quality of life for the people of our region. Our current transportation system, as you heard, is very challenged today. In addition to the statistics that people give about growth and delay and all of that, think about it. Our transportation system lacks resilience, especially around peak hours, and that means that it can't get around or recover from seemingly minor events. Does anyone remember March of last year when a fish truck turned over on Highway 99 and what that did to the entire regional transportation system? That's a lack of resilience. That means we are so close to peak capacity that we can't handle things going wrong in the system. And that's today. What will our traffic be like tomorrow when our population grows by that additional 800,000 people? What people spending additional days and weeks today in traffic than they did in the past? It's time spent away from their families, from work, from life. And we're losing billions of dollars in this region to wasted time, wasted fuel, and lost productivity. About $1,500 per commuter, according to the Texas A&M Transportation Institute, which studies these things. So there's no one answer to this problem. We've been investing in our roads, and that was, in my opinion, the right thing to do. We've been expanding I-405, replacing and expanding the 520 bridge, among other multi-billion dollar mega projects on our roads. But these expansions alone will not fix our transportation problems. We have a great bus system in Metro and our other regional bus providers, but they are experiencing more demand than they can possibly meet. Has anyone been on a 212 or a 554 recently? Or the 550 around rush hour? I mean, it's elbow to elbow, if you can even get on the bus, because if you wait at the wrong stop on your way back, the buses will go by because they're full. This is crushed road, and this is what we're seeing with our systems. We need a fully functioning mass transit network to get people out of traffic, provide a fast, reliable way to get where we need to go. So how does Sound Transit Proposition 1 help? What it will do is fundamentally complete the transit system we've been talking about in this region for over 50 years. You've seen the map. ST3 will connect our urban centers and suburban cities by light rail, commuter rail, and bus rapid transit. And with this plan, we're also going to provide better access. That's something that I don't think you heard about. It was important to me that we put investments in the plan that enable people to park and actually get onto the system, because this is a huge problem in many of our places. With ST3, there will be new parking in Kirkland, Renton, Sammamish, Kenmore, Lake Forest Park, and Bothell, among other locations. We will also be making investments in pedestrian and bicycle access so that people who can walk and bike to the system can do that safely and comfortably. And we're going to build better connections so that if you can ride a bus to the network, you can easily get off and make a transfer and get into the regional system. Yes, even in the suburbs. When ST3 is complete, the Sound Transit system will account for 700,000 boardings daily. To put that in context, I-5 carries about 254,000 vehicles a day through Seattle on average. I-90 carries about 150,000, and SR-520 moves about 75,000. And if you assume the regular average of about a person and a half driving on average in each one of those cars, the system that we are building will be commensurate to those three roads put together. So beyond the statistics, what would ST3 mean to you and to me? It means fast, frequent, and reliable transportation. So to paint a picture, starting with my own commute, because it's the one I know the best, when ST3 is built, I'll leave my house, I will walk four houses down to the next main road, and I will hop a local bus, probably the 226 or the 271, which will take me the short ride to the light rail system at Eastgate. From there, within just a few minutes, a train will come that could take me to my job in Seattle. Easy, fast. Make this your own trip. Maybe you have a local bus, or maybe you don't, and you carpool to a park and ride, or take a rideshare company like Uber or Lyft, or say it's 2041 and you hop in one of the fleet of driverless cars that is now constantly roaming your neighborhood, because that's going to happen. It's not my plan, but it's going to happen. Any one of these will take you the short trip to the light rail station, and maybe if you work in downtown Bellevue or Redmond or at Microsoft or in Kirkland at Google, maybe you go to school at Bellevue College for classes or take a class at the new UW, well then it won't be new anymore, Tsinghua University, the Global Innovation Exchange in the Bell Red area. Maybe you're retired or have a day off and you're going to Issaquah to shop at Costco or to Seattle to watch the Mariners play in the World Series, which I can say because it's my hypothetical. You could be going to SeaTac or Boeing in Everett or Boeing in Renton in the equally fast, frequent, and reliable BRT system. You get the picture, it's a network. It will go everywhere. It will connect all the major places that we want to go. Wherever you're going, you will not need a schedule. You'll show up and the train or bus will just come in just a few minutes and take you where you need to go and home again when you're done. So this plan gets us out of congestion, provides fast, easy, and reliable transportation. But there are other benefits besides transportation. You heard a bit about the economic benefits. Gridlock is a tremendous threat to our regional economy, and the Puget Sound region is home to 70% of our state's economic activity, so gridlock is a threat to our state economy. In 2015, congestion cost our region almost $3.2 billion, or about $1,500 per resident. In addition, it's really damaging to people's economic opportunity and ability to have a good quality of life to not have reliable transportation. There have been studies recently at Harvard which found that for low-income families, the lack of reliable transportation is the single biggest barrier to moving up the economic ladder and improving people's lives. Bigger than housing costs, bigger than education, the biggest barrier. This program will provide jobs, 200,000 direct and indirect jobs, and with 25 years of constructing this plan, that's a lifetime, a generation's worth of good construction jobs. Our major employers know that to attract and retain talented and hardworking employees, they need to have a way to get to work. So that's why major Eastside employers support Proposition 1, including Microsoft, Expedia, Group Health, REI, Snapdoodle Toys, it's my favorite, and many others. Proposition 1 also benefits our environment, and you heard that, I thought, very clearly in the presentation from Sound Transit. So you'll hear from opponents of the plan a few things. You're going to hear that we can invest in buses more cheaply and that driverless cars will make transit obsolete. So starting with buses, first of all, we need every kind of transit that you can think of because we need different things in different places. Simple matter of geometry, you saw the slide. one four-car train can carry as many people as 10 buses or 500 cars. So a light rail train can carry far more people than any bus, and it's more efficient to operate, more cost-effective, because you have one driver per train and 10 drivers for each of those 10 buses. So how can people claim that buses are cheaper than rail? Because you will hear that. They're making an assumption. They're making an assumption that you can run buses on the existing roads, not have to build any new construction, and that therefore it's much cheaper. But if you just put more buses out on the road, what happens? They're sitting in traffic with everybody else like we are today. It's not rapid transit. There's no magic to the R in BRT. It's only rapid if you put it in its own right of way. And building the right of way is almost as expensive, actually it's just as expensive for buses as it is for light rail. So if we want to get out of traffic, that's where the cost comes in. The statement that buses are much cheaper than rail is a really misleading claim. Another question you'll sometimes hear, but why not just build more road capacity? That will solve congestion. And that is a debate that we could have for all night long, but I will say two things about that. One is that we've made some decisions in this region that we don't want to pave over our entire region. We have rejected building a new superhighway out in far eastern and rural King County. This plan is what's necessary if you don't want to pave over your entire community. Importantly, roadways are also very expensive. Look at the 405 project. They're expanding that existing fairly wide road, adding some lane miles, adding some direct access ramps and other items, and that entire project, when all complete, will cost around $11 billion just for expansions to that one road. So roads are not a panacea. Also, there's the concept of what they call, where is it now? I'm gonna get this wrong, but induced demand. I think that's the word I'm looking for. And this is that if you build it, they will come. It's been proven many times that if you put more road capacity out there eventually, demand will fill up that road capacity and it'll happen pretty quickly. So another question that I'd like to just address quickly before it's time to wrap up, which I assume is coming. Why not wait? The future is coming. Driverless cars, like I said, that will solve everything, will it not, right? Again, driverless cars are a very promising technology. There's lots of ways that they can be deployed that will really help parts of our system. But they cannot and will not replace a mass transit system because of the same problem with that slide again. A driverless car takes up exactly as much space as a car with me sitting behind the wheel. It's not any different than that. And so if you put a bunch of them out there, it actually can make congestion worse, or it could make it better, depending on how we deploy them. But it cannot take the place, those 500 cars would have to take the place of the one light rail train. It doesn't matter if there's an Uber driver, or me, or nobody, you can't get around the laws of physics. And finally, the major complaint, and the thing that I assume we will talk about during Q&A, is that people will say it costs too much to do this, just costs too much. My answer to that is it costs too much for us not to build a light rail station. We are already paying with our time. We are paying in traffic. We are paying in lost productivity. And the cost can be dramatically overstated. You saw the median household cost was about $169 per year, or about $14 per month, which is less than a double tall skinny vanilla latte once a week, and I would have reason to know that. I went on the Sound Transit website and tried out their calculator today. I ran my family's house, which costs more than the median average. I ran my income, which is more than the median, and my car, which is significantly less than the median, but it's the smallest part of the calculation. And we pay here on the east side around $300 per year or $25 a month. More than my skinny vanilla latte a week, but not as much as two skinny vanilla lattes a week. So still within the range of something that I personally could do. But again, by not having a transit system, we're paying anyway. We're paying with time and lost productivity and all the economic and environmental damage that we have. So the bottom line is there is no other plan. This is the region's plan. I'm gonna skip that part and jump right to the end. So do we wanna join the list of generations who have punted this problem for decades and decades, or do we want to do the right thing and get to work now? I know my answer. My answer is yes. I ask you to join me and vote to approve Sound Transit Proposition 1 on November 8th.
right. Bellevue City Council Member Kevin Wallace is setting up his presentation now. I'm also going to take this moment to remind you that you are welcome to start writing questions if you have them on those little cards that you have. Like I said, someone will pick them up and they will give them to me because I know we want to hear them. So without further ado.
Well, thank you all for coming out tonight. As Steve said, dodging through traffic at probably the worst time that we could possibly have held this event for traffic. Probably good. It puts it all in perspective to it for us. I'm Kevin Wallace. I'm on the Bellevue City Council. Claudia and I, actually, Council Member Balducci and I, served together as mayor and deputy mayor last year. So everything that she said about her resume on transit, except for serving on the Sound Transit Board, is something I've also done. I was noticing when you were saying that, it's just like we have basically the same resume. So we both spent a lot of time working on transportation policy issues for Bellevue. And, you know, in a lot of ways, we have similar views on things. We both think that all modes of transportation are important, just some to different degrees. In my view, what we need to do, and the flaw, the problem with the Sound Transit 3 plan is not that it's transit, it's that it's the wrong kind of transit for the wrong places. And the other part about it is, and sort of what this slide alludes to, if you can read it, is that we need to find a balance, right? I mean, we can't raise tax revenue for everything. And there are other things like human services, like affordable housing, like education and public safety that also have needs. And so we need to be very prudent with our tax resources as we're looking at transportation planning or any of these other things. And as you'll see in my presentation, ST3 is just out of scale. It's too much and it's not doing the right things for transit and transportation needs. Go ahead, Steve, thanks. So this is basically what we're getting in with the existing tax revenues. Sound Transit 2 and Sound Move are under construction right now. If you go into downtown Bellevue right now, you'll see the stations under construction. And by 2023 or 2024, light rail will go through the highest density areas of our region. It'll go through Seattle and Bellevue, out up north to Linwood, east to Redmond, and south to Des Moines, Kent area. For another $1 billion, we could extend it down to downtown Redmond from Microsoft's campus where it is ending now. And another $1 billion, we could extend it down to Federal Way. So light rail, which is appropriate for the highest density areas, as Councilmember Balducci pointed out, is being extended to the highest density areas. If you go to the next slide. So the rest of the areas, and what these maps are showing is all the different bus service agencies that are providing bus service to the lower density areas, and even to the high density areas. But we have great plans for Metro, Community Transit, Pierce Transit, Sound Transit. All of them are providing good bus service. Go ahead to the next one. And that allows service to the lower density areas. The other thing we need to recognize is not that driverless cars are going to completely supplant everything in 2040 or ever, but that they're providing alternatives, and not just driverless cars, but changes in technologies, making transportation technologies, cars more efficient, and transit more efficient. And where that technology change is leading to is to smaller, more flexible vehicles that can run on electricity, that can be more flexible to the needs of the commuters who can access them by their smartphone apps and other things, and basically aren't as expensive and rigid and permanent as light rail extensions are. So as we're looking to the connection to the new technologies, we really need to be thinking about smaller, more flexible transit vehicles. Go ahead. This is how we grow in the region. Despite massive efforts to try to densify, we don't. This is the whole Puget Sound region, and the dots show about 150 people growth over the last generation. So the point is, we have a lot of areas in RTA, in Sound Transit's area, that need service too, not just Seattle and Bellevue, but places like Sammamish and Kent and areas that are lower density, and they need to be served with bus. Go ahead to the next one. This, just to bring up a point, Councilmember Balducci said that light rail is the same cost as bus rapid transit. Well, this is a study that Sound Transit did 2 years ago. It compared Kirkland to Bellevue to Issaquah, looking at different modes of transit, and importantly, comparing bus rapid transit to light rail transit. And what they found was that bus rapid transit costs about $885 million to go from Kirkland to Bellevue, past Issaquah, up to Sammamish. Light rail transit costs $2.6 billion to go from Kirkland to Bellevue to Issaquah. So you say, well, it'll produce more ridership, right? That would be a better investment, even though it's more than 2.5 times the cost. Answer, no, it actually produces more ridership with bus rapid transit because you get to extend to Sammamish and cover more territory. And if it's just from Kirkland to Issaquah, it's exactly the same ridership. So bus rapid transit in lower density areas like Issaquah is less expensive, can be delivered faster, and produces the same ridership, according to Sound Transit's own studies. Go to the next one. So this slide is talking about how Sound Transit has new revenue coming past 2024 if we simply extend the existing tax rates. We don't need massive tax increases to generate new revenue for transit from Sound Transit. Now, yes, they would have to go to the voters and ask the voters to approve extension of the existing tax rates or a small tax increase to do some of these things. But what this is showing on their own data, between 2024 and 2041, they would produce $8.6 billion of revenue just from the existing Sound Transit 2 tax rates. And that doesn't count extending the CARTAP tax out further beyond about 2028, which produces another $2 billion. So if you take those things and you leverage them with bonds and grants, there's about $15 billion, according to their own numbers, that could be applied to new transit services without raising tax rates. Go ahead to the next slide. This is their map of the plan. Go to the next slide. The next slide shows the map of the new stuff without the existing stuff. So you see it gets a little more sparse. Basically what this plan breaks down to, go ahead and click it again, is you've got the early stuff and the late stuff. The early stuff is much cheaper and is actually really good projects. You've got bus rapid transit on 405 and 522. You've got an extension to Redmond. You've got an extension between Kent or Des Moines and Federal Way. All of those things are going to cost about $5.5 billion. And remember I said there's additional money that could be applied without raising tax rates to those good projects. But the problem with ST3, go to the next slide, is the rest. These six light rail extensions cost 85% of Sound Transit's capital budget in the ST3 plan. And they're basically, they're extensions that don't get finished until 2030 at the earliest and 2041 at the latest. And in the case of extensions to like Linwood to Everett and Bellevue to Issaquah, they're going to low density areas where bus rapid transit could be doing the job just as well for much less cost and much faster. You could get it on the ground well in advance of 2041 and start serving the commuters of today, not the commuters of 25 years from now. Go ahead to the next one. So this is something for a takeaway, but it just basically going through Sound Transit's model, we can get this out to people so they can look at it. And just laying out the cost of each of the projects, the one that's delivered before 2030, make up 15% of the capital budget. The ones that deliver after 2030 make up 85% of the capital budget. So that's really those later projects are what's driving all the need for this tax increase, almost all. And you get, I mean, some of the costs are just incredible. $4.3 billion to go from Kirkland to Bellevue to Issaquah. $5.8 billion to go from Linwood to Everett. Okay, it costs less than $4 billion to replace the 520 bridge. So these costs are just out of scale. One little example, if you took the distance between Des Moines, the south end of ST2's light rail, and Linwood, the north end, is about 36 miles. If you took a stack of $100 bills and kept on stacking them until they reached $54 billion, the length would be 36 miles. So it's almost exactly the same, stacking it in $100 bills, as it is from Des Moines to Linwood. That's how much $54 billion is. Go ahead to the next one. The point of this slide is that according to Sound Transit's own information, this comes right out of their own appendices, and Councilmember Balducci mentioned the 700,000 trip number. It's a little too small, but the bigger number here is showing, according to their own information, without ST3, you'd have 663,000 trips on transit in 2040. With ST3, after spending $54 billion over 25 years, you would have 727,000 for a difference of 64,000 trips moved to transit from other trips. Well, according to the PSRC up above, we're gonna generate about 4 million more trips in the system between now and then, between now and 2040. So this isn't making even a dent in our traffic. And if you think your traffic commute on 405 or I-5 is going to get better for spending this $54 billion, you're in fantasy land. You're in fantasy land. Go ahead to the next one. So let's talk about how much this really costs people. Sound Transit likes to say that it costs the average individual, Claudia even said the average household, $169 a year. And that's true, but it's an individual that makes $39,000 a year in income, has a $5,300 car, and a $183,000 home. And even still, that's only the increase. It doesn't count what they're already paying to Sound Transit. Okay, the total that person would pay is $295 a year. There's three taxes we're talking about here. Sales tax would go from 0.9% to 1.4%. So your Bellevue and Seattle tax rates would be over 10%, at or over 10%. Car tap tax goes from 0.3% to 1.1%. So on $50,000 worth of cars for a round number, that's $550 a year in car tap taxes. And then property tax is $25 for every $100,000 of value of your home. Okay, so let's look at an example of a normal household. Okay, next slide. If you're making $90,000 a year in income, you have $45,000 worth of cars and a $450,000 home, you will pay Sound Transit $1,007 per year, every year, to Sound Transit, okay? The increase is, I guess I don't have it on here, part of it's the existing and part of it's the increase. So it's $390 you pay them now, and you pay them an additional $616. I encourage you to go to noST3tax.com and calculate for yourself how much you pay to Sound Transit every year and over the 25-year period before Light Rail delivers in Issaquah. Go ahead to the next one. This is showing how much tax revenue Sound Transit is going to take out of our system of government over the period that we're talking about. And they say, well, it's a $54 billion plan between 2017 and 2041. But the truth is the bonds and everything don't get paid off until 2060. And it also excludes the fact that they're already collecting taxes for SC2 and Sound Move, and those don't end either. So if you add it up, you've got $31 billion, $32 billion from SC2 and Sound Move over the 25-year period, plus $27 billion from the ST3 for a total of almost $60 billion over just the 25 years. And if you run it out to the 2060, it's $162 billion. All this comes directly from their own financial models that I got from a records request after waiting a month. So you can, you know, look it up yourself if you have the models. Go ahead to the next one. Oh, actually, I want to just point out that, you know, this is showing how the revenues increase with ST3's passives. They'd get to $2 billion a year in collections in 2024, $3 billion in 2036, and it just keeps growing and growing and growing. Go to the next one, please. So the last thing I want to talk about is priorities. We have in Olympia coming up in January something called the McCleary decision or levy reform or public education funding, and it is a genuine crisis. This is something they've been working on trying to resolve for 5 or 6 years now, and it's basically the result of a Supreme Court decision where the court correctly said that it's our constitutional paramount duty to amply fund public education from a stable source of revenue. Okay, now that sounds all very complicated, but what it means is you gotta have the tax money coming from the state coffers not being approved by local levies every 4 years to fund public education. And what that means, unfortunately, is that the way we've been doing it is gonna be very expensive to correct the way we have been doing it, especially for the high property tax areas, property value areas like Bellevue and Seattle and Redmond and most of the areas where Sound Transit's jurisdiction is. And so what this is showing is one of the proposals that the Senate was working on a year or two ago would have had Bellevue's property taxes going up by $1.53 per thousand. So on a $1 million house, just for round numbers, that's $1,530 a year tax increase to solve the problem, okay? Now, is that going to be where they end out? Probably not, but it just is to show you the scale of the problem that we have to resolve next year, only a few months after this vote in November. So you gotta keep in mind all the other taxes that are out there. Craig Kinzer, who's a friend of mine, was on the cover of the Puget Sound Business Journal with me this week talking about this issue. He's in support of SD3, and of course I'm opposed. And he referred to it as a moonshot. This is our moonshot plan for the region. What I'd like to say is the moonshot should be education. If we wanna give a gift to a baby that's born today, when that baby is 25 years old, it shouldn't be a light rail extension to Issaquah. It should be an education. We need to get that child the opportunity to compete in the modern world. That's the gift we should give them. So if we're gonna raise $54 billion in tax revenue over the next 25 years, let's spend it on that, not this. Let's work on something that's
prudent and cost-effective for our transportation needs, but not this wild spending of 6 light rail extensions in the 2030s and 2041. And I guess with that, I will right on time raise your hand.
Okay, so I'm sure with all of that information, you guys will have questions. To start off, I'm going to ask a couple questions for both of our speakers. They can each answer. And so let's start here. If ST3 passes, what steps will your group take to hold Sound Transit accountable to the public as they control the contingencies, opportunities, and problems coming in these next years? So I guess I'll hand it over to Councilmember Balducci first.
Thank you. So I'm going to reframe the question a little bit, because after the election, both Smarter Transit and Mass Transit Now probably go on the back burner, if not going away entirely. But I will speak for myself. As an elected official that represents the East Side, as a member of the Sound Transit Board, it will actually be my responsibility and my job to make sure that we are managing the projects, delivering them, and being careful stewards of the money that the voters have approved. And you saw when Sound Transit was speaking that we have a number of accountability measures. Some of these are standard, some of these are special. There's quite a lot of oversight and audit that comes along with being a transit agency delivering capital projects. We have a number of audits every single year, and we have passed all of them. We have got a citizens oversight panel. In fact, and I don't want to embarrass him or anything, but one of our soon-to-be new members of the Citizens Oversight Panel, assuming that the board approves it, is here tonight. These are people not associated with Sound Transit who have various expertise and come from the community and will look at and review our performance and give us critical feedback, and they do that quite well. There's an expert review panel, as you heard, that is also required to review our work and look and make sure that what we're doing makes sense and meets certain standards. We are a highly regulated and overseen agency, and we also have a board of elected officials who come from different jurisdictions, who are county and city officials, who are responsible to the communities that elected them to their positions to make sure that we're doing the right thing with the taxpayers' dollar. And we have been doing very, very well in the last couple of decades. I want to just allude quickly to something that is written about a lot, but you all are probably aware that in the early years of Sound Transit, there were challenges. The first project very nearly didn't get off the ground. There were scope management problems. It was not on time. It was not on budget. And the whole thing had to be re-scoped. After that initial challenging period, management put in place some very tight controls, fiscal controls, management controls that have worked very well ever since. And in the last two decades, our projects have been on time and on budget. Our current projects are on time and on budget. And the review of our projects that are coming up shows that 97% of what we're doing is trending on time and on budget, which is a far better track record than most public agencies.
Well, I've spent a lot of, actually, I do spend a fair amount of time looking over Sound Transit's information. And I think, you know, one way to look at it is they do a project and they come in under budget and we have a celebration. The other way to look at it is, you know, a private sector construction project has a contingency of about 3%. Sound Transit's project contingencies are over 70%. And so if you load in, if you have a $1 billion project and you have $700 million of contingency and then you don't spend all the contingency, I'm not sure that entitles you to brag about coming in under budget. Perhaps you should just not go to the voters for a massive tax increase with billions of dollars of contingencies in this $54 billion plan, which is the case. So if they could get out and refine things and reduce the contingencies, they wouldn't need to have such a large tax increase, even to do the same projects, even though they're way out there and really not all that useful, some of them. You know, I think other things that they do is they budget their interest in their budgets at 5.3%, and they borrow their money at 2.3%. That's a huge difference. Over 25 years, that's billions of dollars. And this is the kind of thing that you'll never see unless you look deep into their financial information like I have, but they have. Another story I'll tell you is that Claudia and I, Councilmember Balducci and I, were up on the, we should be respectful, right, of each other and give us that decorum. Claudia and I, like I said before, we're put on this planet, I think, to fight with each other for your entertainment, but we actually do really get along very well with each other. I have a lot of respect for Claudia and the things that she's done, even though we disagree on this issue. But a quick story about the contract we worked on with Sound Transit in Bellevue when she and I were together, looked for ways to save money for each side. And one of the things was a project that Bellevue was building a road over where the light rail was going. And so we said, Sound Transit, you have your contractor do it for us, and we'll just pay it. Surely that will be cheaper, right? Because they're already out there doing their project. It's lower risk, and they can do it on their own schedule. So the cost comes back, and it's $26.8 million for the road. And our transportation staff pulled it back, and I wondered why. Well, it turns out we didn't have enough money to do that at $26.8 million. So we resubmitted the bid to our own public sector contracting process, which is not the cheapest solution out there. Had six bids come back, and the lowest one was $12.5 million for exactly the same project. That's one little project. If that doesn't give you pause and concern about how this agency is operating, I don't know what will.
What was the highest?
Well, Sound Transit's contractor's bid was $26.8 million, and our contractor's bid was $12.5 million. So, you know, that's a huge, huge gap, and that really requires some explanation. I think these are the kind of things that Sound Transit and the legislature really need to look into about this organization before they're given more money.
All right, we're going to go ahead and move on to.
Can I just say one quick word? All I can say is that I know that Kevin has spent a lot of time looking and poring over spreadsheets for Sound Transit. I sometimes think if I went to City Hall and looked out the window in the middle of the night, I would see the fires burning in his office across the street, sort of, you know, just going over these things. But our finances, the way we budget, including our contingencies, are reviewed by the Federal Transit Administration, which looks at these projects for the entire country. They are heavily scrutinized by auditors, and nobody has come to us other than Councilmember Wallace to say that somehow we are wildly out of whack. So while I know that he has done his homework and he believes what he's saying, nobody else is saying what he's saying.
So I'm going to.
But he's still right.
I'm going to. I'm going to move on to another question. So this one is actually a very technical question for Sound Transit, and I think you will be happy to answer it. It asks to clarify: does light rail go to Issaquah or not? It does. Do you want to clarify that a little bit more?
Yes, with this plan, with the ST3 plan, light rail would go to Issaquah in 2041.
An even better question is, why does light rail go to Issaquah?
Anyway, so here's another one for both you guys to kind of debate here. This time we'll start with Councilmember Wallace. If the ST3 enabling legislation fails, please describe how the group you represent will address the issues of growth and congestion in our region. How will those efforts differ from ST3, and how can the public hold you accountable, if that makes sense?
First, so, you know, the solution really is about using the right tool for the right place. It's about high density transit solutions in high density areas and medium and low density transit solutions in medium to low density areas. And so as I said before when I gave my talk, there's a lot of things in the ST3 plan that are very good. Those things that are $5.5 billion in total costs and get delivered before 2030, right, in our lifetimes. Those are all bus rapid transit and things that get buses out of the road right away, out of the general flow of traffic, extending the light rail line to Redmond, extending it to Federal Way, building more park and rides. All those things are in the ST3 plan. They're all very good. They just don't require the largest tax increase in state history, creating this massive burden on our families. So, you know, as this moves forward, if it fails, and I hope it fails, I hope there's an adult conversation with Sound Transit, who's ultimately going to be the person coming up with the new plan, about trying to scale this plan down, doing what I like to call ST 2.5, and having something that doesn't require such a significant tax increase and focuses on using bus rapid transit and other bus transit services in the lower density areas.
Thank you. So it may be one of the best kept secrets around that there actually is a Puget Sound Regional Transportation Plan. It's called Transportation 2040. It's developed and approved by the Regional Council, which is a body consisting of representatives of all the jurisdictions in the four county area of Pierce, King, Snohomish, and Kitsap County. And it is a compilation largely of the local and agency plans, like Bellevue's transportation plan. Major projects show up in the regional plan, and so does Seattle, so does Sound Transit. But it's studied, it's looked at every few years. We look at this plan and we look at how it compares to growth and traffic and transit demand, and we look at all the different modes, roads, buses, transit, and we ultimately make a decision as to how we think we should be proceeding as a region for our transportation needs. And that plan is voted on by the General Assembly, which means it's almost like Noah's Ark. The representatives from every organization are called out one by one, and we all, and from Algona to whoever's last in line, there's no Zilla here in this county, in this region, but you know, every single jurisdiction has to vote on it, and every single jurisdiction has approved that plan, everyone. That is our regional plan. This proposal is in that regional plan to build a light rail system, to build a mass transit system. This is the regional plan, and it didn't come out of nowhere. It's been developed over decades of discussion and study and public input. This plan, when we put it together to put this chunk of it, this last big chunk out to the public, we had over 40,000, almost, not quite 40,000, I think it was 38 something thousand comments from people telling us what they wanted. We had all of the cities writing in. We had a very robust public discussion and technical planning, and this is the regional plan. This is it. There is no alternative plan. The opponents don't have a plan. They've never had a plan, and they still don't have a plan. If this doesn't pass, well then, we don't have a plan. So we might go back to the drawing board, but with the public telling us they want this light rail system and the transit that comes with it, with the jurisdictions telling us this is what they want, who's gonna write a different plan? Who's suddenly gonna say, let's flip that and instead build a bunch of freeways everywhere? There's no other plan. To me, the only decision in front of us is, do we try to, and shoot the moon? I don't know, what game does that come from? Somebody?
Hearts.
Hearts. The reason this is a shoot the moon is because we're asking people to approve a big chunk all at once instead of the next step, right? We could have asked, can we do the next step? But what we heard loud and clear from the public was, just build it already. Do it now, do it as fast as possible, get it done. We've been talking about this for decades. So that's what the ballot measure says. It says, do you really want us to get it done all at once, shoot the moon? It doesn't mean that we're actually trying to build something that isn't necessary. We're building to the regional growth centers. And by the way, I gotta stand up for Issaquah a little bit here. Issaquah's got a great center city plan, and even though they have their issues now, it's a short-term thing. They're going to grow out over the next 2.5 decades into a real regional center. And wouldn't it be great to have the transit come to them when the growth was coming, as opposed to 20 years after it was already there, like we're looking at in places like Ballard? So. There isn't another plan that anybody has proposed, and I don't know what the other plan would be.
All right, thank you. I have a question here specifically for Councilmember Balducci, sort of two things. One, clarifying who you're here representing. What is the organization? This person asks, are you an employee or a consultant? I don't know if they mean Mass Transit Now.
Yeah, as I said, I'm here tonight talking for Mass Transit Now. That is the committee that is the pro yes on ST3 committee, and I am working for them as a volunteer, as you do when you work for campaigns. I do it all in my spare time. Here I am at night on my own time doing this. It's not as part of any of my jobs, and no, sadly, I am not getting paid.
So then the second part of this question, would like it if you could break out your claim of ridership by 2040 with light rail trains of 6 cars. The question is, how are you getting to 700,000 riders?
So the number for 700,000, and I will defer to the staff on this if they have a different answer, is for the Sound Transit system, which includes, as I said, we've got different modes. We've got commuter rail, we've got light rail, we've got regional buses, and we will have bus rapid transit. That's the total projected trips that we will carry each day in 2041 after building ST3 on those modes, but just for Sound Transit. That doesn't include the other transit agencies.
All right, here is a question I have for
Oh, by the way, I'm sorry, can I just add one more thing?
Go ahead.
Thank you. I really, I don't want to argue, but I do not know, and I would love to know, where my friend here gets his $64,000 number from, because in ST3 on the map, as you saw, one of the extensions, it looks small on the map, but it's an extension to Ballard, from Seattle to Ballard. That line alone is going to carry more than 64,000 people a day. So how the whole system could possibly be believed to carry 64,000, it's just completely not a rational statement.
That's a point of clarification, because your slides, I think it said 650 or 600 some odd thousand boardings, but a person gets on and rides twice, so that's only really 350,000 people.
I'm going to let Karen speak to that, but you have to count what you can count, right? And we don't have a way, like people don't have chips in their heads yet. Maybe they'll get that with the driverless cars. But if I had a chip in my head, they could maybe track me. I got on and off four times today. That's one person. But there's really, we don't have the data yet to do that. And so we count trips. Boardings. You count boardings.
I thought it said boardings.
Boardings. That's what I meant to say. Boardings.
Well, it's half as many people.
That's, we don't know that.
I think we're not. What we know is that it's 600,000.
Most people read it one way. No, I thought they read it.
Well, it depends on the
trip
Since we went there, let me say that the numbers that I was comparing it to, the trips on I-5, 520, and 90, are also just one way, not both ways. So you would divide those numbers by two as well, and you would still have a system that essentially has the same carrying capacity as I-5 through downtown Seattle, 520, and 90. And who would say that that is not a really significant amount of traffic capacity?
So,
yes, if you have a question, please write it down.
So just to clarify, the 64,000 is, if you look, and it's actually in the appendices to the ST3 plan. There's the main plan, and there's appendix A, B, and C. And I can't remember which of the appendices it's in, but there's a chart that shows the transit trips with Sound Transit 3, $54 billion, and the transit trips without spending $54 billion. And the difference, they provide it in a range, but the midpoint of the two ranges is a 64,000 trip difference. If anybody wants to go look at Sound Transit's own information and tell me they did it wrong or I read it wrong, I'd be more than happy. But I've checked, to me it's unbelievable too. I've checked that many, many times, because it's just so hard to believe that for spending $54 billion, all you could get out of it is 64,000 trips moving from other types of trips to transit. But that's what the numbers say. Yeah, but what it's comparing is if you do ST3 or if you don't do ST3, right? We still have transit if we don't do ST3. We still have light rail to Linwood, to Redmond, and to Des Moines if we don't do ST3, right? So it's not like the world stops if we don't do ST3, okay? And that's what, your own engineer's data is showing that. So, I don't know what more I could say about it, but I'm just using your own numbers and telling people what they say.
All right, it looks like a lot of people have some clarifying numbers questions, I know. If you want to come up here and we can try and work through some of these together, and hopefully we can hash out all the details that you guys want to have hashed out. So, the first question says, I'm going to read the whole question. Congestion relief is a critical need for Puget Sound area. What percentage of the total trips in the area, car, bus, bicycle, walking, will ST3 handle for the $54 billion that is requested? Is that something you can?
Yeah, I can speak to the gym.
Here, I'm gonna grab the mic here.
So there's two elements to that question. The question was basically, what's the percentage of trips? Will the package, Sound Transit package, can I see
you
again? It's kind of long.
Percentage of total trips in the area will ST3 handle?
Okay. So there's two elements to that. There's one that's looking at when do most people travel. If you think about traveling in the middle of the night on any of our area freeways, unless there's, you know, a major road project going on or WashDOT has shut down or a bridge, the congestion that would exist during peak hours isn't the same. The amount of time that it would take you to make that trip is pretty reliable. If you're going out for milk at 2 a.m. or coming home from somewhere at 2 a.m., there's not a lot of traffic. So the overall amount of trips, if you think about if you make several trips in a row, if you go to get gas, if you go to the store, if you go to visit a friend's house, each of those are individual trips that you're making. And again, if you're looking at making those in hours when there isn't a lot of congestion, the predictability of how much time that trip will take you is fairly consistent. Right now, over 40% of the trips during peak hour into downtown Seattle are made by transit. To downtown Bellevue, I think it's around roughly 15%. Maybe a little bit higher than that, approaching 18%. 17, that's exactly right, 17. And so what that is looking at is saying that when most people are making the most amount of trips during those peak hours, what is the reliability of those trips? Sound Transit 3 will increase, I don't have the numbers off the top of my head, will increase during the peak hour the percentage of folks that are making those trips by transit. So it's probably an alternative that is congestion-free when most people are traveling and things are the most congested.
Can I provide an alternative response? So the point is well taken. The original question was how many trips is light rail accounting for of all the trips, and that is less than 1%. Transit in 2040 make up about 4%. Light rail is less than 1% of the total trips. But it is correct that what we need to be looking at in high density areas is basically how much is transit absorbing of the PM peak hour commute trips, right? Because that's when we're really worried about traffic congestion and what light rail and other transit forms are solving a problem for, to the extent they do. In downtown Seattle, in downtown Bellevue, the mode share for transit is 50, like you said, 45-50%, 15-20%. In downtown Redmond even, it's less than 10% still. Downtown Issaquah, it's less than 10%. And as you get out to these lower density areas, that's what's happening, which is why it's not necessary to build a high density solution like light rail in areas like Everett and Issaquah and places that just don't have that transit mode share. And they will not in the future. So we can spend a whole lot less money and have a whole lot less tax increase and provide just as good a solution for these lower density areas. And we still are going to have light rail in Seattle and Bellevue without raising tax rates at all.
All right. We'll have one more response, and then I want to make then I want to institute a rule. When our first response, we're going to limit that to 2 minutes,
okay.
And then rebuttals will be a minute.
Sounds good. I think I can do a minute. First of all, the percentage numbers that are typically quoted about transit share, which is what this question was, what was the share of transit, are 24-hour numbers that come from that four-county region I talked about. So they include Kitsap in the middle of the night. We're not building, if that was our goal, we would not be proposing this plan. Let me just assure you, we're proposing this plan for the central Puget Sound at 4:30 or 5 o'clock on a weekday. That's the challenge, that's the problem. The problem is, you know, that fish truck overturned and shut down the system, that was during peak rush hour. When there are games, when there are incidents that happen, the system can't handle it. So your trips become very unreliable. During those times, transit share is significantly higher and going up faster than other modes. Light rail ridership is going up faster than any other mode of travel. That's because the congestion is driving people to make different decisions. And that's today. We're still not talking about that almost million people that are coming here that are going to be moving to all the dots that Kevin showed on his map, but are going to be going to work in our centers in Seattle, in Bellevue, in Redmond, in Issaquah. We have major employers in all of those places.
Thanks so much. Another question here. I don't know if you can help me with this one. This might be more for Councilmember Balducci. So the question is, when Sound Transit, you know, when Sound Transit is under budget, what happens to the money that they're paying? And, you know, if they are under budget, can it help reduce taxes over time?
If a project's under budget.
Mm-hmm.
So Sound Transit has a series of financial policies. Mr. Wallace mentioned appendices that go along with our plan. Appendix B talks to the financial policies, and there is a plan laid out for what can happen if a project goes under budget. And that is up to the board. The first element is that the money would could be looked at within the sub area. The board could decide to apply it to another project. I'll let Claudia speak more to that. But there are rules set in place for how those would be considered at the board level.
It's another great opportunity to look at money that could be spent before we raise taxes. And right now in the financial models, for whatever reason, there's one project where they booked $40 million of project savings. All the other projects, every newspaper article you read where there's hundreds of millions of dollars of savings, which really means they didn't deploy all their contingencies, they have not applied that to the ST3 stuff before they went out and looked to raise more taxes. So let's get in, you know, vote no on this thing, and let's get out in the next year and the year after. If we get 4 years down the road and the ST2 capital has been deployed and they've borrowed the money they plan to borrow at lower interest rates and spent the money they need to spend at less than 76% contingencies, then they would have more resources to be able to allocate to these new projects.
Two very quick points. First of all, if we waited until the end of ST2, and then did all the post-project accounting and decided how to spend the money only at that point, we would have probably a 5, 6, 7, 8 year delay in starting the next set of projects, because there's planning, there's votes, there's design and engineering that has to happen before you can start construction. Part of the timing of this plan is to get projects on the ground, continuing the projects in ST2 end in 2023, 2024. The projects in ST3 start to come online immediately in 2024. The second point is, you know, when Kevin talks about you could have $15 billion or you could use this money here or this money there and do something else, he's creating a different plan than the one the board and the community created. Who gets light rail and who doesn't? With $54 billion, we can go to Everett, Tacoma, Redmond, Issaquah, West Seattle, and Ballard. Who's left out in the plan if we decide that we just want to do a third of it?
All right, thank you. And then I have one more clarifying question, then we're going to turn to some more pro-cons. The question is, how about fare and ticket revenues, where they fit into this plan?
Fare revenue is also included in the resources that would be available to make up the $54 billion.
Do you know what percentage?
I will look and get that right back to you.
Is it so low?
Is there a response from either of you to fair revenue? I don't know if there's a...
Public transit overall, and this is not unique to Sound Transit, fare box recovery, and Sound Transit has some of the higher ones, particularly on Link, is not enough to cover the operation of the system itself. It's a subsidized element that's provided to the public. And so because of that, we include fares within the overall revenue that's available, but it's not going to be enough to pay for the projects themselves. We have to look for additional revenue sources.
Go? No? So I can't remember exactly what the fares are, but they're in the range of $1 to $2 a ride. Does that sound about right?
No, they're not.
Yeah. How much is the fare on light rail right now? $2.75? Okay, so it's $2.75 for the trip. That doesn't change if you make $50,000 a year or if you make $250,000 a year. And what we're talking about with the fares is, we're basically raising tax revenues using the most regressive tax rates, the ones that have the biggest impact on families that don't make a lot of money, to generate the revenue for this train, and not charging fares to people that make a whole lot of money, who are basically using it to make their commutes faster to downtown Seattle. So really, there should be some look at means testing these fares and reducing the tax rates that we're imposing on lower middle income families.
First of all, I believe in public transit as a public good. I am willing and I advocate for providing public transit, even if the riders don't pay out of their pocket the exact cost of it every time they get on. I don't pay the exact cost of the roads I use either, but public transit does come with a higher level of subsidy, and I support that. I think it's important to a civilization that we have this good, like we have public schools. Secondly, we do have a low income fare now. It's a new thing, relatively innovative in this region, so that if people do have serious low income, they can get a break on the fare so that they can ride. So there's a kind of a means testing that goes on. But yeah, I just fundamentally believe in public transit, so I'm okay with that.
All right, this question is, it's directed at Councilmember Wallace, and the question is, who will pay for the alternative vehicles, and what infrastructure will they use?
Well, first of all, to be clear, you know, I don't hitch my wagon to driverless cars. As I hopefully made clear, I'm a believer in transit, and we're in a window where we still need to have more transit service. It's just not that we just don't need light rail extensions in 2041. The promise of driverless cars, though, is real. The promise of changes in transportation technology that make our existing commute in cars more efficient and enable us to get more out of the existing road system is real. And the really neat thing about it is it's all being provided, well, almost all of it's being provided by the private sector. So you have these companies working, massively large companies working on this right now and deploying these great new technologies that will allow the system to be more efficient and provide people more choices. So those things really need to be taken into consideration as we're looking at our plan. And the PSRC and Bellevue Sound Transit and others are only just beginning to really take a look at this. It hasn't really been incorporated into the thinking and the planning processes for transportation in the region. But you're starting.
This one is directed to both of you. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you each 1 minute to respond to it, since it's for both of you. This says, I heard Bellevue is not supporting ST3. What are the reasons?
So I will take the laboring oar and say the Bellevue Chamber of Commerce voted to not support ST3. The Bellevue City Council is taking this up next Monday night, so stay tuned and see what they decide to do. They have not decided yet. I don't want to speak for organizations that I'm a member of the Bellevue Chamber of Commerce, actually, but I didn't vote on their position, so I will hand this to Kevin, who did possibly vote on their position. I don't know if you did or not.
You and I spoke at the same thing. We were both asked to leave, remember?
Oh, right.
Yeah. So, I'm really glad this question came up, and I think you are too, because we are not representing, she's not representing King County Council or Sound Transit. I'm not representing the Bellevue City Council or Bellevue. These are our personal positions. We're with the campaigns, and so it's completely separate. The Bellevue City Council is going to take a position on this. We're gonna have a nice, robust discussion about the same issues on Monday night, and you all are welcome to hear the same thing from me again, either at the council chambers or watch it on TV.
Yes, from the comfort of your own computer.
That's right.
All right, and this question is for Councilmember Balducci. It says, why should we vote for something that won't be ready before we die? So, I assume it's a lengthy
I would not
question.
Advocate that you vote for something that won't be ready before you die. This plan will start coming online the year after ST2 is passed, and I don't see anybody here who looks like they're fixing to die in the next 5 years. You're all gonna be with us, right? So, 7 years of math, but if you, with this plan and ST2, you will have new major transit service coming online every 3 to 5 years from now through 2041. So we will see, and as you see, some of the East Side investments are the earliest investments. The extension to Redmond is 1 year after the Bellevue light rail line opens. The bus rapid transit on 405 and 522 is the same year, 2024. You don't have to wait until 2041. But I will say this also, I've got a 10-year-old son, and I was a little younger than him when we were, no, actually, I was not born yet when we were having this debate, but I don't want him to be my age in his 40s standing here talking to another group of people about why we still haven't built our transit system. And somebody asked him, well, but I'll be dead when it's built. You know, come on. At some point you have to say do it or don't do it. And obviously you know where I stand.
So, I mean, the great thing is we did it. We've already raised the taxes. The light rail train's coming in 2024. There's a lot of good things, as I mentioned, that can be done in the ST 2.5 plan between now and 2030 in our lifetimes that solves the transportation problems of today and only costs about $5.5 billion of capital expense. So you don't need nearly the tax increase that they're talking about. What's driving the massive tax increase are these extensions out between 2030 and 2041 after a lot of us won't be here anymore. And certainly they're not solving our transportation problem of today. So again, if people think that this is going to make their commute on 405 or I-5 any better in their lifetimes, they are in fantasy land. It's just not going to happen.
All right, this question is directed to both of you. So again, I think we're gonna stick with that 1 minute each. It says, how do these options, pro and con, relate to growth resurgence? And they're asking a question about regulations and a word I can't quite make out. But I think the question is, you know, how is each side looking at population growth?
I'm not 100% sure I understand the question, but I'll do my very best. The growth that we know is coming, so in the last year, about 86,000 people, our population increased by 86,000 people. That includes both natural increase, what we call, you know, having babies, and also people who have moved here from other places. That's like 10 people an hour on average, and that is slated to continue for decades. We are looking to have 800,000 people more in what is today a 4 million person region. That is another fifth again as big as we are today. That's what growth is driving us to have high capacity transit, not just buses sitting in traffic, not just congestion constantly getting worse with no relief and no way to get out of it, but true high capacity transit like they have in other big congested cities and regions.
So I was just looking up, in 2040, the Puget Sound Regional Council forecasts how many trips are going to be made in the region by car. And the answer is 83%. 83%, 4% on transit, 83% on cars. So we are going to grow, but we're going to grow a lot more car trips too. And so again, the point is, you know, if we're gonna spend, why would we spend $54 billion to move 64,000 more trips onto transit when we can spend a lot less money and provide lower density transit solutions for people in lower density areas and build some park and rides for them to access the system as they get closer to the higher density areas.
Okay, I have a few more questions that I think Karen can help us out with.
Excuse me, I just want to point out that we have about another 6 minutes allotted to the Q&A time.
Gotcha, okay. That is great, but I think we're saying it right about now. If you have any burning questions, that's the last time you can submit them. So if you have a question, write it down, submit it, and these will be the last sort of round of questions that we'll take.
And that would bring us to the 44-minute time.
Right. After which point, I think it would be really useful to make closing statements. I think tonight that would be a really, really great idea for everybody. So those closing statements will be, I believe, 3 minutes each. If you can look at the agenda before me, right quick, timekeeper.
Yes.
Gotcha. So 3 minutes each for those closing statements. So I'll take something like six more questions, probably, if I can get that many, and then we'll close. So these are some clarifying questions. Thanks, Karen, for helping us out here. This one asks, so this is another clarification on ST3 about Issaquah and Sammamish. It says, why is there an argument about ST3 going to Issaquah or possibly to Sammamish? Why can't it go to both? Please clarify. So I think we're still a little confused about where light rail is going to on the east side.
So the Seminole Transit System Planning Process began in January of 2015, and we had a lot of stakeholder engagement, community outreach, to look at where the corridors should connect to. So the question about Issaquah and Sammamish, Issaquah is the urban growth area, it's the urban area within King County and in that section. And the plan goes, takes light rail to Issaquah. And so to clarify about that, one of the elements that we would work with our partners, King County Metro in this instance, is looking how to provide connections to the Issaquah light rail from areas like Sammamish and others on that side of East King County.
And one more regarding East Side. So it says, I'm just gonna get to the question here. Please explain the light rail from Issaquah to Seattle. Can one get off at Eastgate and Sumter to light rail to Seattle, or does one have to go to Bellevue? So I think it's the series of stops between Issaquah and Seattle.
There would be a stop at Eastgate. What was the second part of that?
It would require a transfer.
We looked at a couple of different options in the planning process. The one that is in the representative alternative would have a transfer at the East Main Station to get to Seattle.
All right. Did that make sense?
So basically, what would it would require from Issaquah, what would be included, is a transfer in Bellevue to the East Link line that would then continue to Seattle.
All right, and I'm...
She's trying to describe a station that doesn't exist yet, and that may be the confusion. There will be a station on East Link at basically Main Street and 112th, the sort of southeast edge of downtown, and that doesn't exist yet, but that's where you would have to change. But I want to say this. Everybody on the board, the mayor of Issaquah, the then mayor of Bellevue, probably the current mayor of Bellevue, would prefer that we could have that exchange happen at the South Bellevue Park and Ride. The challenge is that there are, and I only have like 10 seconds, there are some very serious engineering challenges in the slough to make a crossing there. And so that idea is not dead, but it couldn't go into the representative alignment because it would have broken the bank. But I am not over it yet, and we will have a few years to plan after the vote.
So that's why there's not light rail to Sammamish, because it would have broken the bank. It costs about $500 million to extend light rail from Issaquah to Sammamish, according to Sound Transit's study. It cost about $40 million to extend bus rapid transit from Issaquah to Sammamish. So they could have done it faster and it would have produced more ridership, but they chose to do bus rapid transit or light rail in the ST3 plant. Serves less people, costs 2.5 times more money. To get from Issaquah to the airport, you would take, in 2041, you would take the train to Bellevue, downtown Bellevue, or somewhere close to it, get off, get on another train, take it to the tunnel in Seattle, get off, get on another train, and take it down to the airport. In 2041, when I assure you there will be some driverless cars.
All right, I'm getting new information now. Sorry, folks. I am going to not limit your time on responses and rebuttals. We've requested to allow you to sort of express fully whatever it is you need to express. Apologies for any inconvenience so far, and I'm watching the clock here. So I have one here that is directed to Councilmember Wallace. It says, your statistics seem to assume that places that are currently low density will remain low density. Why do you think they will remain low density when they are generally also less expensive than high density areas and have land available for creating high density housing?
Well, they don't have land available for creating high density housing to the degree that you would need to create the density that supports light rail. There's never going to be a time when Issaquah has the density of downtown Seattle or the University District or Capitol Hill. If you just go look out there, it's mostly swampland between Lake Sammamish and very already built out single family residential areas, and there's just not the community support to have that kind of density. There is a town plan for creating some medium density apartment projects, and they're going up, they're being constructed. But the level of density that they're going to have in Issaquah whether it's 2017 or 2041 or 2061, is sufficient for bus rapid transit service. Light rail is just not necessary.
So we're dealing a little bit, you know, we talk a lot about numbers here, but we are dealing a little bit in the realm of opinion, right? So the city fathers and mothers in Issaquah certainly believe that their plan will be well served by light rail, and they are supporting and advocating for this plan. Some of the land developers in Issaquah, including the largest land developer in Issaquah, is supporting this plan because, you know, we're standing in a low density area. There's some apartments up and down 148th, but when you get much past that, my neighborhood, small houses on medium sized lots, it's the definition of low density. Go out on 148th or on I-90 on a bad day and tell me that because we're low density, we don't need transit that gets out of traffic. Of course we do. And you know, I think we're also starting to talk a little bit of shorthand, because I know what Kevin means when he talks about BRT, but when he starts to say we could build BRT for a tenth the cost and it would carry more people, he's again talking about buses sitting in traffic. He is not talking about building right of way or setting it aside specifically for the buses. They will be mixed in with traffic and it's just more local bus service. It's not the same thing at all. This system that we're wanting to build will provide out of traffic, congestion-free, fast, reliable transit. Buses in traffic are not that.
So just as a follow-up to that, I agree that there are bus plans that are in the flow of traffic. The plan that I'm talking about between Kirkland, Bellevue, and Issaquah, and all the numbers that I cited, was from a study in 2014 that was done by Sound Transit's engineering firm, CH2M Hill, and it analyzed bus rapid transit route outside the right-of-way versus light rail, and obviously in its own dedicated right of way. So in that particular project, that's what I'm comparing.
All right, and with that, the time for questions is up. I'm really sorry if I couldn't get to your question, but I hope this was really useful. Right now, I'd like to open it up for closing statements from each side. Councilmember Balducci, if you want to begin, you have 3 minutes.
This has been a great discussion. I really appreciate all the questions and the discussion that we've been able to have. I will be able to hang around for a little while afterwards, and I'd be happy to answer one-on-one or in small groups any additional questions that are burning that you really didn't get answered. But I will say this, the bottom line, this is our opportunity to build out our transit system in this region. Anybody who's traveled anywhere else, I was born and raised in New York City. Every major metropolitan center has got congestion and they've got a transit system. There's no reason we can't have it except that we continue to choose not to make the investment. There's an there's a little bit of a false choice being presented here. Do transit or do education? We need both. We need both. Our kids need to live in a region where their parents can get to and from their jobs and get home to be with them, to help them with their homework, to help to raise them. And that's part of the reason why you have these longitudinal study at Harvard that's showing that reliable commute access is the number one thing that helps families in poverty to move up out of poverty, because they can take care of their life and their jobs and get home and be part of their community. So there's no other plan. This is the region's plan. It's been developed over years of long-range planning. I think I've said this before, but I think it bears repeating. It responds to the transportation needs of the region as they have been identified through years of studies at the Regional Council, at our cities and counties, and the plans of Sound Transit and the other transit agencies. It reflects tremendous public input, tens of thousands of comments, hundreds of people coming out to meetings, and that's just this latest round, and this was not the only round of planning that we did. And we have heard from cities, seniors, students, communities of color. We didn't get to talk about equity and social justice at all tonight, but transit is a huge component of being an equitable region. People who drive and people who depend on transit. We heard from the breadth of our regional committee, and when you add up what they told us, it was, it's our time, we should build it, get it done, do it now. That's what we heard. And so that's what we're proposing. And I believe the time is now. This is our opportunity. Kicking the can down the road for some other plan or some new mode or some magical thing that might come along and fix our problems has not worked to date, and it won't work in the future. So I mentioned my son before. He's 10 years old. And I mentioned that I was almost his age 40 years ago. I want him to have the same opportunities I have had, to live in a great region, to be able to have a job, to be able to afford a house, to get around. I don't want him to be standing here doing this when he's in his 40s, talking about building a transit system, as I said before. I want him to look back and know his parents did the right thing for his generation, for the future, and for us. That's why I've worked so hard on this plan, and I'm supporting it, and I urge your support as well. Thank you.
Okay, so, you know, basically we have a transit plan that, you know, this is not the only plan. We need a plan that provides a reasonable amount of revenue going to transit and leaves a reasonable amount of revenue for other things like education and basically for our own pocketbooks and our ability for our businesses to prosper in this region, right? And the tax increases that we're talking about here are so large, you should legitimately have concerns about both of those things. Your own pocketbooks and the business ability, the economy to continue to thrive. Most of the projects in this plan can be built and delivered before 2030. What we're talking about, I mean, not most, but a tiny fraction of the cost of the plans can be delivered between now and 2030, and they'll do a good job for more transit, right? And remember that ST2 is already providing a great light rail system, and we already have what many regard as the seventh best transit system in the country without raising tax rates another dollar, okay? It's coming. So the point we need to have here, we need to make here, is that let's focus on this 15%, the ST2.5 that doesn't require a large tax increase, only maybe a small one, and it puts off these extensions into low density areas, at the very least until we know more about them. But really, I mean, let's take a look at delivering light rail, using light rail as a tool in a high density area like downtown Seattle and Ballard, and let's leave bus rapid transit as the solution with park and rides for places like an extension from Linwood to Everett, from Federal Way to Tacoma, from Bellevue to Issaquah, because there's just not the density for those places. You can do equally good a job serving that population with transit, with bus rapid transit, as you can with light rail. And then what that's going to do is leave us the revenues, the tax revenues, the resource we have in the property tax and the sales tax and the car tab tax to do other things like fund our fire stations, like fund education, like fund roads and sidewalks. All of these things are government needs that we have, and they're going to continue to be there whether ST3 passes or not. So we really need to be prudent and be thinking about the bigger picture. Light rail extensions are a thing. They're not the only thing. And we can do a better job in being cost-effective about the transportation solutions over the next 20 years and not having these massive tax increases that, as Reuven Carlisle, a Democrat representative from Queen Anne, said, suck the oxygen out of the room for all other governmental services. I'm 10 seconds early. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, everyone, so much for being here. Thank you to Karen Kitsis from Sound Transit and to Bellevue City Council Member Kevin Wallace and King County Council Member Claudia Balducci. We really appreciate your time. Thank you.
And can we also please give a big hand to our moderator, Simone Garcia. Thank you very much.